North Carolina Cooperative Extension is working with growers across the state to help them minimize microbial risks in fruit and vegetable production by teaching them about GAPS, good agricultural practices. GAPS are common sense practices that growers can incorporate every day to reduce the possibility of food contamination. More and more produce buyers are now requiring proof of GAPS certification from growers before they will conduct business. Small growers need to be knowledgeable about GAPS because they offer such a wide range of crops and often sell those crops directly to consumers. In addition, the U.S. Senate has initiated a bill to address fresh produce safety, with the Food and Drug Administration beginning to develop guidelines on the subject. The movement is toward requiring some element of GAPS for all growers. In August 2010, a mock third-party audit for potential GAPS certification was held at the Center for Environmental Farming Systems, or CEFS, in Goldsboro, North Carolina. Hosted by Cooperative Extension, the audit was conducted by Ed LeClaire, senior auditor for NSF Davis Fresh, a firm specializing in consultative audits. Participants included local growers, extension agents, and farm interns. The mock audit focused on CEFS' small farm unit and evaluated seven areas: farm documents, water sources, employee policies, chemicals, farm observations, employee behaviors and working conditions, and harvest operations.
Training. You need to get on the internet, get available information, get training materials. And it's a good idea to find out what is the intent of the requirements. Why do we need to have good agriculture practices or GAP in our operations? And GAP is basically common sense once you look at it. I think the initial feeling from farmers is that, oh, I don't understand why I'm doing this. By having everybody compliant with common sense food safety GAP requirements, we can assure the food supply is safer. And it's probably safer now than it was 40 years ago.
The small farm unit at CEFS is about 40 acres. Farm manager Steve Moore and his crew of apprentices and volunteers grow several dozen small fruits and vegetables and also have long-term pasture areas with cattle and annual cover crops. There is a 12-year rotation, with six of those years in soil, building perennial sods used for cattle grazing. The cattle reduce the amount of mowing required and provide nutrients and potential income for the farm. An audit usually begins with a review of general farm documents. Growers must supply a produce safety plan that shows the history of the land, something that proves the farm was not used for hazardous operations such as mining or municipal waste disposal. The plan also has inspection logs, reports, and policies that reflect current growing operations. Pre-season and ongoing risk assessments are essential components of any produce safety plan, where factors such as worker hygiene, water quality, waste management, and animal activity are also considered. Next to consider are water sources for the farm. Is the water source reliable? Is the water used free of pathogens and other contaminants such as generic E. coli? This includes water being used for irrigation, chemical mixing, frost protection, and other applications. The small farm unit at CEFS uses 95% city water, with some well water for drip irrigation and some overhead traveling gun irrigation from the Little River. Water samples need to be taken close to the source of the water and processed by an accredited lab. Insulating and locking up the pump house, installing a backflow preventer on the pump, and testing water regularly for pathogens and contaminants are simple ways for small farms to start GAPS around water sources. General policies and procedures for employees need to be in writing. One of the most important employee policies for a small farm is one that covers toilet and hand washing facilities. Good personal hygiene and proper hand washing are critical to preventing foodborne illnesses. There must be one toilet facility for every 20 employees, and that facility must be within a quarter mile of where workers are located, no more than 5 minutes away. A simple way to reduce pathogens is by having employees wash their hands for a minimum of 20 seconds with soap and potable running water to remove potential contaminants. Signs can be posted to provide visual reminders to employees on proper procedure. It's also important to address employee illness and injury through a written policy. Employees who have the flu should not have contact with farm produce or equipment and could be assigned to other duties. Employees who have cuts and abrasions should cover injured areas with bandages and wear gloves. A well-stocked first aid kit should be available in all areas where employees are present. Supervisors will need additional training in how to recognize symptoms of illness and how to manage ill employees. An employee policy that outlines restricted behaviors and worker responsibilities is important. The use of tobacco, food, and jewelry, and the presence of children and animals in the production area are examples of what could be included in this policy. All employees need to be trained in basic food safety and personal hygiene and be able to demonstrate their knowledge. Growers need to consider their unique and diverse production practices when creating GAPS. Growers who run U-Pick operations provide local produce, educational opportunities, and fun for the surrounding community. U-Pick farms also have a responsibility to protect consumers by safeguarding their produce from possible contaminants. Visually scouting fields before picking, limiting customer and animal access to certain fields, and encouraging proper hand washing and restroom use are all simple ways to reduce risk for U-Pick operations. GAPS focus on microbial contamination of fresh produce. However, farmers also need to look at how they use fertilizers and pesticides, since these products can inadvertently increase the risk to produce and the environment. The CES Small Farm Unit is certified organic and follows the laws and regulations concerning pesticide application from the National Organic Program and the Environmental Protection Agency. Pesticide use, handling, storage, disposal, and documentation are all regulated by state and federal laws. Integrating these laws into your GAPS program is essential. Regularly calibrating sprayers, posting signs to identify treated areas, and locking up chemicals and fertilizers when not in use are all examples of GAPS. Visual farm observations and documentation of farm conditions and employee behaviors are straightforward, effective ways to strengthen your GAPS program. CEF's employees often walk the fields to check on fencing, natural barriers, and buffer areas to look for signs of deterioration and animal activity. Keeping the fields free of garbage, culls, and other trash is important for reducing potential food attractants. Having a documented system of cleaning and sanitizing harvesting equipment is fundamental for GAPS. Visually observing employee behaviors such as hand washing, tobacco or jewelry usage, and first aid practices ensure that employee training is effective and that procedures are understood and followed. GAPS should address growing, harvesting, and post-harvest activities for fresh fruits and vegetables. The Seth Small Farm Unit was harvesting blueberries on the day of the mock audit. CEF's policy requires that employees follow a standard operating procedure, which is posted on a clipboard in the shed where harvesting containers and tools are kept. Clean plastic containers are stored upside down and off the ground to reduce the possibility of contamination. Prior to harvesting, employees visually check the fields and make sure their hands are clean. Blueberries are harvested into containers, which are placed on a wooden board to keep them off the ground. Then they are placed into a gator and transported to the harvest shed. Tractors or gators can be used for other tasks as long as they are properly cleaned before transporting produce. Containers may be covered with lids, depending on the distance to the shed from the field. Post-harvest activities of washing, packing, sorting, and transporting ensure the quality and safety of the blueberries. At CEF's, all surfaces are cleaned and sanitized prior to the blueberries being weighed and washed in a dedicated sink with city water. Harvest knives need to be made from sturdy, cleanable materials such as stainless steel and stored safely away when not in use. Ideally, items such as towels are either single-use or cleaned professionally to reduce the possibility of contamination. All cleaners and containers must be approved for use, stored in a separate area, and have material safety data sheets kept on file. Storage refrigerators must be well lit with no personal food containers, mercury thermometers, or breakable light bulbs. Produce and harvest bins need to be stored off the ground so dirt and debris from the entire floor can be cleaned regularly. When not in use, consider storing harvest containers upside down. The area outside of the harvest shed must be free from debris, with all wastewater captured from the produce sink. Currently, the GAP certification process is completely market-driven. More produce buyers, large and small, are asking for proof of fresh produce safety due to the rising number of outbreaks. Since small growers often sell directly to local buyers, their commitment to safety practices is critical. Growers should assess their individual market and economic needs.
For us, it was really important to get this audit. It really helped to get fresh eyes to look at the farm, to get somebody that's a trained specialist to really see what the farm looks like. We really realized that the importance of the audit to have for the demand of the consumers and retailers, and to have peace of mind and do the legal due diligence that we can assure food safety. I think also from a marketing point of view, it'll open up new markets that weren't available. It'll make other markets that we have, we can be more unique and therefore more competitive in those, and hopefully in the end get a higher value for our product.
I think the tools that we learned today will help us go back and improve some field sanitation as well as pack house sanitation. I don't think there's really anything that's going to be too hard to implement. It's going to be a matter of taking a lot of time to get things on paper and to get your standard operating procedures and that sort of thing. If it's 5 years from now that we need to be GAP certified, that we can move ahead and at least lay some groundwork so that can happen a lot easier when the time comes.
Simply put, GAPS represents the best management practices for food safety that many growers already employ. The GAPS certification requires that those best management practices be written down. The actual GAP audit criteria depends on which third-party auditor the grower contacts, but most of them last for 1 year. The continuing process of education, identification, and implementation of GAPS is much like our agricultural systems and should evolve with each season.